everyone, and welcome to the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am still Wade Price, and regular listeners will probably not be surprised to learn that I am delighted to be joined by today's special guest, who is Nick Baton. How are you doing, Nick?
Hello, Wade. I'm very, very good. Thank you much indeed. Good to be back on the podcast, and what a lovely intro, as always. Thank you very much indeed.
Got that one down. Got that down. So we're going to talk about Adeptus Titanicus today. I thought like a nice little opportunity to check in on a game system that you and I both love. Demonstrably, we've got the video evidence of it on the Twitch channel. And it's been a while since we've really talked about Adeptus Titanicus on Warhammer Live or the podcasts. And there's been quite a few releases over the course of the year. And there's been an awful lot of 40K and a bit of Age of Sigmar and a bit of Warcry to talk about recently. So a fine opportunity to check in on the game of ginormous titans stomping around, smashing stuff up. And in preparation, you've been checking out our rewatching our old Tale of Four Princeps series on Warhammer.
It's a guilty pleasure, Wade, but every now and again, whenever I have any excuse to go back and watch any of the old series on Warhammer Live, I do. And I spent my afternoon yesterday watching the Tale of Four Princeps series, all of it, back to back, all the way through. We went from sort of like barely knowing what we were doing to barely knowing what we're doing, but with painted titans.
And shouting engine kill, which I think is right, that's kind of the arc of a player of Adeptus Titanicus. I'd never played Adeptus Titanicus in any of its, well, any of the kind of epic incarnations. I associate that different scale of miniatures with a number of different games from the past of Games Workshop and my past as a hobbyist. There was an original Adeptus Titanicus, there was the Space Marine game, there's Epic 40,000, there's Titan Legions, there's been a number of different game systems at that scale in the far future. But this is the first time that I really embarked on it. Had you played any of those kind of iterations of bigger games before?
So bigger games, yes. In the past, I'd always been a big fan of the smaller scale games, Wade. I played Epic back in the day, a big fan of Warmaster, and the biggest scale game possibly we've ever done, Battlefleet Gothic. I do believe that Adeptus Titanicus was in its own right, was it the first small scale large game we did? Is that right?
I believe original plastic Warlord's Titan that you could paint as a loyalist or a traitor for that kind of civil war, that ambition of staging the galactic civil war. Both sides have got the same things. Get involved if you like. And I remember talking to Andy Hoare when this edition of Adeptus Titanicus came out, and we did some interviews on Warhammer Live. And I guess my time in the hobby, I probably started in the hobby maybe just after that first edition of Adeptus Titanicus was present and active. I was aware of the materials and stuff that were around, but I was getting into 28 mil 40k scale and Warhammer scale stuff, so it was kind of in the periphery. I was always aware of it, and I think I played an intro game of Titan Legions. Do you remember when the Titan Legions box came out in like the 90s with the Imperator Titan and the Orc Mega Guard?
I remember that
being in the Bristol store, and I played some of that. That's great, but I was 15 and I was trying to get armies together for other game systems, so I never really got involved in it, but I always wanted to, because this is war on a new scale, isn't it? That's the kind of ambition for these sorts of games. Takes everything that you thought about from the battlefield perspective of the troops that you play Warhammer 40,000 or Warhammer with, and everything gets upscaled massively, and the lives of the little ants stumbling around in the feet of the titans, inconsequential. You get a completely different take, get a more strategic overview. You get bigger battlefields to look at, and you get to consider things in a totally different way. So I was delighted to get involved in it. And we had a great group for that Tale of War Princeps series.
Yeah, it was really, really good fun, wasn't it? All of us took it very much in the same way. We all approached our hobby from a different aspect. Some were collecting, some were mad converting. I was more about the painting, but we all came together and had some really fun games. What was really good there, Wade, is we were all approaching sort of playing the games from a sort of similar experience level. I think I've been playing the game for about 6 months at the point we started Tale of War 4 Princeps, and I'd played about four or five games and spent the rest of the time painting madly. So I had a little bit of an idea of how to move and shoot, but most of us in the group didn't really know much, and we sort of built our knowledge together as a group all the way through under the tutelage of the mighty and powerful Rob Crouchley, who was our Princeps Senioris for the entire show, who basically taught us how to play live on air. Which was really cool. And I was watching it back again, thinking like, for anyone who's ever thinking about getting into the game and wants to learn how the game works, it's a fantastic way of going back and watching it and learning how to play. To answer your original question, Wade, no, I didn't play Adeptus Titanicus back in the day, but yes, I've always been a fan of these smaller scale games. And I think, like you said earlier on, the thing for me is like that where our games like Warhammer, Warhammer 40,000, Age of Sigmar, the games where you're sort of in control of an army, you feel powerful like a general, but you feel even more powerful when you're in charge of you know, 85 foot tall hulking war machines that are smashing its way through the city and firing huge guns. And at the same time, I've always sort of felt Adeptus Titanicus is almost like battleships on land, if it makes sense. They're sort of like, it's almost a naval game, and these things are moving so slowly, and they're firing massive guns at each other, and it's all about you're getting your deployment right, getting your tactics right, and of course the actual Titans themselves are so big and so powerful and take so much damage that it takes a lot of hits to bring one down. And so the game, even though you've only got 5 or 6 miniatures on the table, still takes a good few hours to play and still feels very, very strategic, which is brilliant.
It is. And the thing that I was most struck by is when you're playing and you've only got a handful of Titans, maybe a few Titans on the table, it's very straightforward to visualize what you'd like to do, because there's only so many things a Titan is capable of doing. Like, they're reasonably limited in their scope. They destroy stuff, and they just destroy stuff in different ways. But to identify the coolest, most cinematic thing that you'd like to do, which for me, with my traitor proclivities, was run forward and hit them with chain fists, if at all possible. Yeah, Rock, absolutely great at articulating. Great, if you want to do that, this is how the rules for Adeptus Titanicus will want you to do this. Make some reactor tests, probably, see if you blow up. But yeah, there's a very different feeling of game. I think that analogy to battleships, I've heard it talked about a bit, like moving battleships, because you kind of need to be able to predict where this big lumbering thing that you're targeting is going to end up at the time that you're able to cycle up your weapon systems and fire. So it definitely gives you a totally different set of challenges to consider. If you like that kind of thing, or you can just say, I'm going to go and punch that Titan in the head, and someone can explain how that works in the game.
It's also so much more granular as well as a game, Wade. What I mean by that is, like, so in a game of 140,000, you've got your land raider there, or you've got your repulsor there. It's got a toughness, it's got a wounds value, it's got an armor save. Great. In a game of Titanicus, a vehicle of a similar size, a Warlord Titan, for example, has multiple different areas on its body that you keep track of all the different things. It's got a plasma reactor. It's got a void shield. It's got two different guns that do different things. It's got guns on its back that do different things. And you keep track of everything on these little data slates on the side of the table. And so there's so much detail you're going into for these things. It almost focuses a bit even more into the background of these Titans. They could have gone down the route of, Titans have got a toughness and a wounds value, but the fact that you've got different areas of the Titan that take different amounts of damage and have different saves, and then you've got the shields, the iron shields on the knights, so much detail, which means that you can happily have a really fun, fun detailed game with only 5 or 6 miniatures or whatever it might be on the table. I love that about this game, the fact that we can actually imagine ourselves as the princeps and, oh no, the engines are overheating, oh no, the gun's not working, that sort of thing. That detail, I think, is fantastic.
Yeah, the little the kind of connective tissue that we all visualized or imagined when reactor tests were failed, and we'd be shouting, oh, Grandad's angry, the Warlord Titan's machine spirit has been
exactly
appeased. We can always imagine what's actually going on in there. Yeah, it was good fun. The Tale of Four Princeps series that we had on Warhammer TV, we should acknowledge the other gamers. So I was representing the traitor side, and with me was Rue, now a studio writer who was collecting an Imperial Knights army, brought a knight army to a Titan fight. So I thought we're going to be a little bit disadvantaged by this, but Rue wanted to really get into some crazy conversions. I think he had a great Dark Mechanicus influenced sort of night world with all sorts of weird experimental stuff that allowed him to go conversion crazy. And then on your side of the table, you had Laura making beautiful Titans to accompany your Legio Graphonicus force. So yeah, you mentioned we had different approaches, what we were looking to do. I wanted to be able to collect a force of Titans. I think that was a great opportunity to plan a little collecting journey. We checked in with some people from the various studios, and I think games developer Tom Clark suggested, well, in your first show, everyone get a maniple. Like, no. We've all got a lot of stuff to do, and we're really looking forward to being able to collect some Titans. And the ambition was to build up a full maniple over the little collecting journey, because getting a maniple in a month was probably beyond the realms. But it was good to see different ways of putting the models that we had together. And again, Rob Crouch was great at presenting the best ways for us to satisfyingly stomp around and blow these things up. Because it took me a while to get my head around the idea of making army lists, because even that is very different to the traditional, like, Warhammer process of find a book, find the list of numbers, add them all up, and away you go. Collecting to a point limit in that sort of regard. The idea of building your army around your battle group, your maniple, and then whatever is attached to your maniple, that's a different notion to it as well, which I quite like.
It is very different. Way keeps using the word maniple, we should explain what that means. A maniple of Titans is a sort of a group of Titans collected together in a sort of and sort of squad, essentially. Although it's not the right word, but there are different maniples throughout the rule, the ways you can combine your Titans together. And you must have at least one maniple when you play a game of Adeptus Titanicus. Although I think in our earlier games, we probably just put down on the table whatever we hadn't played some game.
And I think that speaks to the beautiful flexibility of the Adeptus Titanicus game system, because like a lot of our games, there are three ways to play presented. There's not just this is the way to do Adeptus Titanicus. There is some guidance on a kind of common language for playing Adeptus Titanicus with other people. But if you're in a like-minded group of friends, you can definitely find some ways of softening some of the edges to allow you to get some stuff on the table. I'm doing that because we had team games as well, where we sometimes had, well, we had enough Titans, we'd have a maniple each. Because it was quite fun. We'd want to be able to make use of the cool maniple rules. Not that Rue ever had any, because he doesn't have any time. So he never got to make use of that. You just got to run forward and be sacrificial. So yeah, having a sense of how you'd like your Titans to operate. You get to make them and name them and give them all their identities and personalities. And then how they operate together on the tabletop, there's an extra kind of layer, an extra dimension that influences how they perform.
I did love those team games, Wade, like the fact that we were it was Laura and myself as the loyalists, and then Wade and Rue as the traitors, and we almost sort of played off each other as doubles quite a lot. I think there was one game at the very early start where Laura's warlord got shot, and it span round completely randomly and let off a shot at one of my Titans. And so exactly, and therefore from then it was like, looking over the shoulder the whole time, was it really an accident? And you guys played off that all the way through as well. It was an in-joke all the way through that Laura and I shot each other.
And if there was ever the slightest sense of a disagreement of how the loyalists were going to proceed, Rue and I jumped on that as a way of pointing out that the traitors were in far greater accord, far greater unity of purpose than these loyalists who seem so fractious and fighting amongst themselves. I'm a long-standing traitor and chaos player. Chaos, where that's the appropriate nomenclature. Traitor, if they haven't really got that far along yet. So I knew what side I was going to be on. And there's a certain freedom, I think, that comes from collecting the side that historically loses. I collect Chaos Space Marines in the 41st millennium. Spoiler alert, they lost the Heresy. They didn't do well in that particular game. And likewise, the Traitor Titan Legions, they have some great fun, but they do lose, and they get driven into the Eye of Terror, if they're lucky, come the end. But it's all about taking out as many of the good guys as you can. That's my approach to all of this sort of stuff, knowing that my faction, my side, isn't going to win the Horus Heresy, no matter how well I might play or how many sixes I roll, or tens. It just becomes a case of like telling the story and seeing how many of them you can drag down with us. So it's quite liberating, I think, to play as the traitors, because I didn't feel any stress in that we needed to win, because ultimately we go badly. So yeah, we just got to kick back a little bit and watch the stress.
You see, quite the opposite to me, man. I've always been a staunch loyalist. I play Ultramarines in 140,000. I played Empire back in Warhammer. I've always been the good guy if I possibly can. And for me, Titanicus was a great opportunity to have these noble, like the absolute protectors of mankind. The banners fluttering in the breeze, the insignia gloriously all over their bodies, you know, the golden trim glittering in the sunlight as they storm forward and blast traitors away. I've always loved that idea. And you're absolutely right there. There is more pressure on the loyalist side because we've got so much at stake. There was one game we played, Wade, on the Tale of Four Princeps, where it was myself versus you and Rue. Laura couldn't make it that particular week. So I had a larger force and I was
defending. You were abandoned.
I was a pile. Exactly what we're talking about. And I was defending the city from the onslaught of the traitor forces. And my I felt such pressure because if the traitors don't win, whatever. But if I lost, I lose the city, countless billions dead. And it's that kind of cinematic thing about Titanicus. You mentioned the word cinema earlier on, and I've always thought that about this game. It's probably the one that is the most cinematic, these giant fighting machines smashing their way through buildings, you know, through the mist and fog as they're coming into contact with each other. We've all seen those disaster movies where sort of like the giant things are smashing the city. And for me, it was kind of like, that's exactly what this game is. You know, the actual human sized thing is so small and insignificant. And these giant protectors of mankind are here to save the day. And yeah, man, that's why I couldn't ever be anything other than a loyalist.
So what compelled you to pick Legio Griffonicus of all the available loyalist legios to go for?
Well, it's going to be a really boring answer, but the answer is firstly, they're the ones that are on the front of the box. right? Yep. My hobby has almost always been opening a box, painting it. I'm sorry to everyone out there who's hearing this. Opening a box and painting it pretty much like it is on the front cover. I love that. And also, not many people do it as well. You don't see many Ultramarine armies around. And well, you didn't when I started mine. And, you know, Gryphonicus was a chance to do the guys, the prime good guys, right? They are the guys that protect mankind. The color scheme was fantastic. I love the sort of drab grays and the flashes of color that come out. Gryphonicus Titans are gray with flashes of yellow, white, and blue with white cream markings on them as well. And the gold trim as well. Really cool color scheme. Wade, I've got to admit, the thing that ultimately swayed me in the end was that I wanted to cover my Titans in markings, and there was a Legio Gryphonicus transfer sheet. And as boring as that sounds, it's actually a really practical answer. Yeah. I didn't have to freehand everything onto my Titans. I could just use a really amazing transfer sheet from Games Workshop and cover them in that. How about you, man? What was your Titan Legion?
So I went for the mighty Legio Vulpa. I have I can't remember what it is that first compelled me. There's a number of influences, I think, that drove me towards Legio Vulpa. Legio Vulpa, the Death Stalkers. They've got a very cool name. I was going to kind of run through some of the Titan Legion names later on because they're quite inspiring.
They are cool.
And the ones that just really let you know on the nose. Death Stalkers. That seems quite full on, really, doesn't it? Yeah, we stalk death, or we are stalking. Yeah. It doesn't really matter what the context is. That's what we call ourselves. And the Legio Vulpa sounds a bit like vulpine, of or pertaining to the wolf. They've got this kind of canid type skeleton heraldry imagery, this kind of nasty look to them altogether. And the color scheme, it looks like meat, essentially. The dark red, dark kind of marbled, mottled red of the armor we sometimes see, edged with bone, so not a metallic edging. As someone who's painted Chaos Space Marines for the best part of 25 years now, I've painted an awful lot of studded banding on armor. You'd be familiar with that kind of technique as well. And to do that as a not metallic color, I think there's an awful lot of different color schemes and hobby stuff that you see in Titanicus that maybe wouldn't occur, or definitely doesn't occur to me, on regular 28 mil or bigger 40K or Age of Sigmar sorts of miniatures. So being able to make them look like they were made of meat, they got a kind of dark mottled red and purple and bone. It's just a weird combination of colors that I might not originally be drawn to, but I have an image in my head of the original edition of Adeptus Titanicus stuff where that seems to be a color scheme that is lodged in some of my formative memories. I can't really associate it with anything, but that has a very strong association with the original Titanicus to me. And also, they crop up in some books that I like. So Mechanicum by Graham McNeil, one of the early Horus Heresy books, there's a couple of mentions of the Death Stalkers. They're not even regarded, not even referred to as the Legio Vulpa in this book, but the Death Stalkers are in here. Can I read you a couple of words from a book that
Please do, always do.
Scene? So early on, the Mechanicum story is largely about the Schism of Mars, when the Horus Heresy hits the Forge World of Mars and the Titan Legions and the Mechanicum start to fall apart. So early on, there was Grand Master Maxen Vledig of the Death Bolts conversing with Princeps Senioris Ulrich of the Death Stalkers. Their apparent bonhomie masking decades of disputes involving ancient territorial rights along the borders of the Lunai Palace and Arcadia regions. So far, just like they live on Mars, they're Titans. That's early in the book. That's before the schism kicks off. The other mention of the Deathstalkers in this book. Along the borders of the Lunai Palace and Arcadia regions, what had previously been confined to heated debate erupted into outright warfare as Princeps Ulrika of the Deathstalkers unleashed his engines upon the fortress of Maxen Vledig's Deathbolts. Caught by surprise, the Deathbolts lost 19 engines in the first hour of battle before withdrawing into the frozen wastes of the Mare Boreum and seeking refuge in the dune fields of Olympia Undi. So they only crop up at the beginning to let you know they're a bit fractious. They've got some territorial disputes. There's kind of long-standing, on the face of it, fairly civilized disputes between some of the Titan Legions on Mars. And then as soon as the kill order goes, they are marching on one of the Loyalist Legions.
I mean, they didn't even question it for a second, did they? They were straight in. Pretty much.
And there's a huge element of the tragedy of the Horus Heresy that there are forces fighting. They don't always necessarily know why that is. And you kind of get the sense through the expansions and the furthering of the story of the Horus Heresy and the role of the Titans in it, when the vassal knight houses get caught up in war. Hurrah! We're off to war, everybody! Because our legion's off to war. Brilliant! Who are we fighting? The Emperor of Mankind? Oh.
I'm out. I'm going to call one now.
Well, if you're out, then you've got to fight against the Warmaster Horus and his legions.
Can we not just be we just be Black Shields? That's fine. I tell you what, it's important to note, actually, because we haven't kind of touched on it yet, but for those of you who might be new to the game or haven't heard about it before, Adeptus Titanicus is indeed set during the era of the Horus Heresy rather than the era of current 140,000, which means there's no sort of like... In the olden games of Epic, you might have had stuff like Elder and Orcs and stuff knocking around, but they're not around at the time. It's all just Titans smashing each other up.
Yeah, just Titans. Titans of days. And with that in mind, one of the other things that I really like is this book, Guy Haley's Titan Death, which is one of the later novels in the Horus Heresy series. And that is the Wars of the Beta Garmin system, where there's the Titan Death, the hugest encounter of Titans fighting during human history. And towards the end of the Titan Death book, Legio Vulpa Princeps get introduced to some kind of like angry, slavering red demonic presences, and they kind of get fused. And you mentioned that the Adeptus Titanicus game is very much set in the Horus Heresy, the Age of Darkness. Some of my other formative influences that I wanted to dig out from my cabinet upstairs. I went and found White Dwarf 148. I knew the number. I knew the number I was looking for. I knew it was White Dwarf 148. And this is... not for the Adeptus Titanicus game, but the Space Marine game, which was pretty much the Adeptus Titanicus scale, but in the 41st millennium. So you had Chaos Space Marines and Traitor Titans. It's where the Khorne Lord of Battle first came out, and the Khorne Demon Engines. And knowing where the Legio Vulpa was going to end up as a consequence of the Horus Heresy stories, knowing that, you know, for all that my Titans might have been driven into the Eye of Terror, they could still be there 10,000 years later on. You know, I'm investing in my Chaos Titans. My Traitor Titans will become Chaos Titans further down the road. And also the White Dwarf that came with the Bane Lord Titan.
Which I remember that well.
Cornate Titan. So those, I think those were a lot of my influences, knowing where the traitors will eventually end up and become full Chaos Titans. I wanted to start introducing some of those things into my collection. But yeah, Legio Vulpa, the Death Stalkers, going to become Cornate one day. What is not to like?
Wade, you are so on brand. I love it. Even in a game where Chaos isn't a thing yet, you're still sniffing out that little hint of corn, and you're like, that's there, the guy's for me. Yeah. And of course, when it comes to your Cornate influence, Wade, you didn't just make Titans, did you, for your collection?
Yeah, I definitely let my Chaos influence slip in as the story went along. I think I had an ambition. I had a few little hobby things that I wanted to do with the Force of Titans. You mentioned Battlefleet Gothic earlier. I painted some Battlefleet Gothic ships when that was around the end of the 1990s. And I am a person who likes to edge highlight everything. I don't know why, it's just how I'm made. And to dry brush stuff takes a little bit of a mental gear shift in me. And I wanted to do something that would encourage me to see how best to dry brush and get the best results out of dry brushing. And I think these miniatures, the Titanicus miniatures, something that we observed quite a few times over the course of collecting and building and painting with them, you can get them to look great really easily, really quickly. And then you can go back and add more details and more weathering and more bits and pieces if you wish. But you can get everything looking great with very different techniques to what I had been employing in the past. So I'd started wanting to broaden out my skills, I guess, with painting a little bit. And I had one particular objective. I wanted to put banners on the Titans. That's what I felt really like. Looked like the artwork, to have kill banners and pennants fluttering from them. So I started with a very modest ambition of, I'm going to put some pennants on some Titans. And I found a few different sources for banners that I thought would work. Annoyingly, they were all different. I never managed to get a consistent set of pennants and banners, but that goes with the chaotic, traitorous look, I think. If it was ordered and loyalist, maybe that would be a different concern. But yeah, as you mentioned, I went a bit mental and made some greater demons and a full-on Chaos Titan for the very end of the installment, knowing that they're not a chaos force, they're a traitor force, but they're a malevolent forms and weird things that the Imperium maybe lacks the vocabulary to identify as demons. But we know that they're demons. So yeah, I used, I think it was Scar Bloodwrath. I picked up a few of the Age of Sigmar Scar Bloodwrath characters to convert into very large Titanicus scale bloodthirsters with wings from Scourges, I think it was, Drakari Scourges. And I ended up using one of them, first of all, just as a little reminder for a stratagem, because just a nice little hobby project to make, and I had one. And then once I'd got three painted, I used them as a banner of Questorus Knights, which are rubbish. But when you make Questorus Knights are wonderful, but compared to Warlord Titans, they are rubbish. but when they look like greater demons, they're really scary, and they attract an inordinate amount of fire. I think I used them in the very final game as a trio, the Trinity of Blood, and then Laura decided that they could not be, so stomped a Warlord's Titan over to destroy them, which they did, because, you know, there are only three Imperial Knights. But then I think the Warlord Titan got wrecked by all the other traitor Titans who had just been waiting for a Warlord Loyalist to wander out and try and kick
them. That was our plan the whole time, was to have Laura get killed first. I didn't actually tell Laura that plan, but it was our plan the whole time, if you understand. That's how it works with Loyalists. Yeah.
She might have been a little bit reticent to follow through with it, if you're not aware of that. So, yeah, getting to convert stuff. I like converting stuff. So being able to convert stuff at that different scale, making me go back to the bits box and trying to find enough cornate trophies and skulls on chains. I think that was the thing I was happiest with my Warlord Titan come the end, detailing it with loads of little skulls and spikes and trophies, which might not be exactly the right scale, but it kind of does for me. And also transfers, as you mentioned earlier, the Legio transfer sheets. Legio Volpa had a transfer sheet, which I got a few of, because I did not want to try to hand paint that. I do like painting stuff by hand, as I mentioned. I like edge highlighting. I don't want to have to try to paint every single piece of heraldry. And I had not really been using transfers for years. I've relied on an awful lot of the sculpted details on the shoulder pads, space marines in particular. So I've just not really been making much use of transfers. So I think this is an opportunity for me to dry brush stuff appropriately and make use of transfers, and also the textured paints. I'm an old school gamer, and I PVA sand onto bases for an awfully long time, and I'm delighted with the range of textured paints, but this is the first opportunity for me to be mixing them up. And the bases as well, the bases on those Titans are such a large canvas to mess around with. We've seen some wonderful stuff, and you I know people have asked you for your recipe for your Titan bases in particular. That was very popular.
Yeah, I thought the opportunity, I the exact same as you, Wade, when I was painting Titans. It was an opportunity to use different painting styles I've never done before. And it was so liberating to dry brush and wash and let it go and leave it. And there's nowhere, you know, I know you went further with some edge highlighting in yours, but literally all of mine are done with dry brushes and washes and a bit of chipping here and there. Like you mentioned, I use it as an opportunity to explore the texture paints for bases and how we could do those. And also other little hobby things here and there that make painting Titans a lot easier. And it was, for you as well, on many of the episodes, Wade, you tell a story about you wanted to mat your transfers down. And there was one day when you walked into the office of beach, you grabbed some glue.
Yes. I took one of my first painted Titan into the office when we were still in the office, and Chris Peach sits at a desk next to me. And I was looking at my Titan. I was looking at the transfers. It was a bit shiny. I think I'd not applied the Lamy and medium as I should have done, and Peach said, "Don't worry, I'll fix it." And he grabbed some PVA glue, white woodworking glue, and added a small amount of water, not very much, but a little bit, and then he just painted it onto my miniature. I said, "Oh, what are you doing?" And he said, "It's fine, don't worry. I learned this from the heavy metal team. This is a way to map down some of the transfers." And I went, "Okay," and it was fine, but it was.
It takes a long time. So your Titan was covered in white glue for a long time. But yeah, the point is, we all discovered new different ways of hobbying than you would do on a 32mm or 28mm miniature. And that was really exciting, actually. And you mentioned my bases. If you want to talk about those, we can do. I use it as a way to explore the texture paint range. Like Wade, I'd often... For most of my miniatures, I usually use sand and PVA because Wade and I are from the past, and that's what we do. But Games Workshop, there's loads of like really cool texture paints that you can use now. And also, painting sand and PVA onto a base of a Titan, it creates a bit of a problem, Wade, because we're so used to that look on a 32mm model. It scales the Titan. What I mean by that is it makes it look like it's part of your 32mm miniature collection. And so therefore, it can make the Titan look a bit smaller and more insignificant, which it shouldn't do. It should be an 85-foot tall fighting robot of death. So actually using the texture paints allowed us to do some cool new techniques on the bases and make them look like they're on dried up riverbeds or fighting through cities or that sort of thing. Really, really cool. I used to Grelin Badlands for mine, and I covered the base in that. But to do it, what I did first was I painted some PVA glue onto the base first. If you've ever done this before, take some of put some PVA glue, paint it onto your base, let it completely dry, and then apply one of the Citadel texture paints over the top of it, one of the cracking paints, like a Grelin Badland, a Grelin Earth, Modern Earth. And what it does is it makes the base go absolutely crazy and cracks like all over the place, especially if you pile it on really thick like I did. So I piled it on really, really thick, left it for like 2 days to completely dry. And when I came back, I had like this absolutely sort of, maybe you can see, sort of dried red kind of look on my bases, which is what I was going for. There we go. That's how I did mine. But an opportunity to explore a new hobby is what I was trying to get for.
The sense I got from using textured paints in quantities for the first time, because I think immediately before this project, I've been doing a little meeting engagement Age of Sigmar project with Ben Bailey, and I was using a Grellin Earth and a Grellin Badland for the first time there. You really can't use too much of that. That was my takeaway from this. Like, if in doubt, put a bit more on, because otherwise it might not crackle or texture up in exactly the way that you want. So that was a useful learning experience. And then weathering the legs of the Titans and keep staring down at the table. Not that if anyone's listening to the podcast, see that, doesn't matter. But if you are watching the podcast, this is my beast. I did not go to the same length. My bases are a little bit sparse, I think, compared to yours. But it's also the sort of thing that once that's dry, it would not be too difficult to throw another few gloops of a Grellin Badland or a Grellin Earth on there, let it dry for 28, 48 hours. Might texture it up a little bit more. Might put a few Legio Griffonicus bits and pieces on there to remind me of some of the glory days of smashing stuff. And magnets as well. That was something that I'd never in my modelling, but that's a feature of these miniatures, isn't it?
It really is. There's a number of hobby hacks we sort of discovered as a group, isn't there, that we sort of came together to utilize. Magnets is one of them, and I think for the first time ever in Games Workshop's history, some miniatures have actually been designed to include magnets on them. So on the Warlords Titans arms and carapace weapons, and the Reaver Titans carapace weapon as well, they actually have little points in them designed for magnets. There we go. You can probably see, I don't know if you can see one there, a little shiny dot in the middle of the carapace there. That's a magnet. It's a 5mm by 1mm magnet, a disc, which is easily available as multi-packs online. And there we go. There's my gun that goes on top. Magnet just pops in like this. And what that meant...
So satisfying.
What it meant is you could swap the weapons around your Titans with ease. And, of course, you can get the weapon sprues and the weapons from Forge World separately. So rather than sort of decide upon a weapon configuration for your Titan and that's it forever, the old Nigel Stillman method, what you could do is actually you have basically your Titan could become like almost like a playset. Check it out, man. So my Warlord Titan, if you fancy using the Sun Fury Annihilator, you can do... Or just pop it off, and then with another magnet, boom! Now he's got a Gatling Annihilator. Yes,
nice.
And it made painting Titans so much easier because I could concentrate on painting the body of the Titan, and then the weapons became its own separate project. In fact, right, I got a whole box behind me over there somewhere. It was literally just weapon arms and nothing else. So I can just go into a game, decide what I want to use in each game. It made it so fun, and like you say, really satisfying.
And something that's helped you in that pursuit, I imagine, is the fact that you built a lot of your Titans in sub-assemblies. Is that right? Built and painted that?
Yeah, really important. One of the biggest hobby things I learned early on, in fact, there was some Warhammer TV videos earlier on that were done about painting Titans. One of the big things I learned was to paint Titans basically as the skeleton of the Titan. You build it as the skeleton, so all the metal bits on the inside. And then all of the armor plating, you leave it on the sprue. Paint it on the sprue. What I used to do was I'd spray it on the sprue, paint it on the sprue. Then once it was painted, clip it off, painting the bits where the clip had, taken the clip off, and then attach them to the Titan. What it meant, Wade, was when I had that armor sprue painted, right, and I had the skeleton painted, the satisfaction of building painted armor plates onto a Titan as it went was so good. But it wasn't just for that. The reason was really to make it a lot easier to paint all the armor sections of the Titan. And also I could spray the colors differently. The skeleton in the Titan, I would spray Lead Belcher, wash it down, dry brush it up. Great. And then because I was Legio Griffonicus and wanted mine to be gray colors, I'd paint the sprue of armor panels, Mechanica Standard gray, and work from then. It just made life so much easier.
Again, I'm from the past and everything in my painting repertoire starts from a black undercoat. And then... a nice healthy dry brush of Lead Belcher to get the armor plates up to that standard, and then painting the armor panels. I do like corn red, so corn red washed with Nuln oil, and then stipping it with some, I think it was Bugman's glow, to make a kind of fleshy mottling meat marbled pattern in there. But I remember coming into, again, talking to Peachy, who was sitting next to me, about some of these ideas, and I said, Peachy, you probably think I'm an idiot, but I didn't paint my Reaver Titans in sub-assembly. He said, it's all right, it's fine. So I've got Peachy on my side, I guess, if we ever get back to this kind of thing. If there's a schism in how to build and paint your Titans, we can use that.
Yeah, Peachy ever painted a Titan, though?
No.
There you go, then. He's like, yeah, it's all right. And I'm like, I've got the wide-eyed stare. As of now you have, of painting my first Titan, having not done that, I'm going, I'm never doing this again. So if you're out there listening and you've painted Titans fully assembled like Wade has, you have my utmost respect. It must have taken so long.
I did this Warlord. This is Manum Rubricata, the Red Hand of Legio Vulpa. And this beast it's quite spiky. So he's got meat hooks and skulls on chains and all sorts of fiddly things. And I had to decide whether or not I wanted to try to paint all of those separate armor panels with butcher's hooks and skulls and things hanging off them, and then try to stick them on, which I thought would drive me mad, or try to paint it in sub-assemblies. And it was the legs, the upper body, and then the separate weapons. The weapons being magnetized meant that I could leave them to one side, but yeah. I would have struggled if this was a single piece to get in. So little greebles, look at that, skulls on chains, unnecessary. But it kind of came together and I'm quite happy with him. But he's not chaotic enough. I do feel like I could go a little bit more mutated with it.
I feel like he's like on the way. We're still in the period of Horus Heresy, so he's going to end up as one of the really spiky bad guys, you know, with a big old gun coming out of a skull sort of thing. But, you know, he's not quite there yet. I quite like that.
It's in the post, I think. You can see it. It's in the post, but he's not there yet. So I've name-checked a few of my Titans. Can you tell me the names of your Titans? Because naming the Titans is also one of the most fun bits of the Titanicus hobby.
So your Titans are all named like horrendous things like Carnage and Blood. Part of me thinks, Wade, like, were they always called that? Or did they have they got new names when they turned it?
No, I think, in my head, certainly my battle group, not to speak of everybody's collection of Death Stalkers, I'm sure some of them are lovely people, but mine are, quite nasty, and it's in the post, I reckon. And I think the names that they have, similarly, I've got a World Eaters force for 40k, and I've been collecting World Eaters for the Horus Heresy as well, and I quite like the idea of World Eaters legionnaires covered in skull trophies and spikes, not even aware that there's a heresy on. Just got back from some mission out in the depths of space. Oh, you must have sided with the traitors. No, this is just what we look like, wuss. So, the names that I had for them. So I've got a kind of a mix. They're Warlord. Now, Warhounds, I've got four Warhounds. There is Merciless, Heartless, Interfector, and Tenebris Carnifex. Interfector meaning killer, and Tenebris Carnifex, Shadow of the Executioner. I can't remember what that means off the top of my head, what the context was. And I like a bit of a mix of naming conventions in that regard, because I think the Titans are ancient and old, and the Titan Legios don't necessarily understand the history or the provenance of them. They just are, and they can kind of make them run most of the time, and they probably don't ask too many other questions. So if they've inherited something with a weirder name to some of the other things, just shrug, and that's just part of its story. So they went from fairly straightforward, simple descriptors, Merciless, Heartless, etc., Tenebris Carnifex, and then the Reaver Titans I have were Umbra Mortis, the Shadow of Death, Malevolent Carnivore, which just means Malevolent Carnivore. I think Black Library author Graham Lyon said that's the most Wade Price name you can consider for me. I'm not malevolent, and I'm not a carnivore. I'm misanthropic, and I have a meat-based diet. And the last one was Sanguinem Oblatio, which means blood sacrifice, which definitely does make you wonder. They were just rocking around as a notionally loyalist Titan Legion. But they were the Death Stalkers. I think accept that that's their name, the individuals are fine.
If you were at the end of that that novel you talked about there, if you were the princeps from the Death Bolts Legion, the good guys, you like, so they're called Merciless, Malevolent Carnivore, Heartless, Shadow of Death, and the Executioner. Are you sure they're on our side? Are they not the bad guys?
Let's not have territorial disputes with these people anymore. They sound terrifying, and I think they might act on it. Manum Rubricata, the Red Hand of Legio Volta, to give it its full name all the time. So, some of them were a bit Latinate. Some of them were English. They're all fine engines of the Legio. What was your naming convention?
My name was entirely Latinate because I wanted to go sort of the high Gothic-esque noble names that you would give to the mighty Titans of Legio Griffonicus. So I've got Titans like Ferox Regum, the Fierce King. I've got Fidelis Servus, the Faithful Servant. Magna Bellator, the Great Warrior. Sometimes I would name Titans based on the weapon configurations they have. As I imagine, it probably represents the kind of fighter they are. So Tempestus Ferro, the Steel Storm, is a Warhound Titan with two bulk and mega bolters. I've got Pugnus Pugnator, the Fist Fighter, who is a Reaver Titan with a Power Fist and a Chain Fist, which is just, I've used it once and it was glorious. And everyone's favorite, mine was Canis Calidus, or the Hot Dog, who was a Warhound with two Flamers. More on him later, but my naming convention was sort of like high Gothic names based either on their sort of service record, i.e. the Faithful Servant or the Great Warrior, or more likely the fighting style that particular Titan had, as I imagine it'd be like a, almost like a warrior tribe, almost like a warrior cast of Titans, these guys. And so they sort of they hold the fighting style of the Titan very highly, and that's where the names came from.
I remember Laura had some really evocative names for her Titans that were different to either of those sorts of ideas, and they were almost like bits of stanzas of poetry, just kind of fragments of terms or text without any context to go with it. I can't remember the actual names because I just kept taking the mickey out of them. In you know, we were at war on the other side of the battlefield with each other, it was entirely appropriate, but they were spoke to another aspect of the kind of history of the Imperium that was then, that there were these ancient things with these wonderful names, don't necessarily know how they came to be, but they can blow up cities, so let's keep
don't argue. We heard the leaves in the wind is coming. Oh, it's got him, it's got massive cannon, is it? okay we'll just not laugh anymore. I think about this is quite interesting, is it because you've got so few miniatures in the game, maybe 5 or 6 miniatures, I should say, and you've named your Titans and your Legio gives you a sort of personality, so you're sort of the brutal traitors, mine are the noble loyalists. Straight away, you connect with your miniatures maybe more than if you had an army of models. You know each Titan individually. You spent a long time painting that Titan. You've named it. You've got an idea in your head about the person that is the princeps inside it. And also, it gives personality to your entire force and, as such, to the way you play the game. So my guys are all the loyalists. We protect, we're stoic, we stand and fight. Whereas you guys, you know, run towards enemy, chain fists flailing, and that ability to give narrative to a game is crucial to make a game really good fun. You can play match play in this game if you wanted to, just sort of line up and fight, that's absolutely fine. But the possibility of adding narrative into every single aspect, every Titan, every model gets a name, everything. It's so cool and adds to that cinematic aspect we talked about earlier on.
I remember over the course of the games, I developed a character and a personality for my Princeps Senioris and his accent, and I was issuing commands. I never channeled that character then. I'd forgotten about him for a while. He'll come back.
Was he the reason you were often crouched in the corner of the room shouting engine kill at people?
I think that was the demonic presence. We were trying to suggest what the demonic voices might be influencing the princeps to do. But the shouting of engine kill, I think that's one of my abiding memory of those games and the sentiment. And when we were talking about it online, and we were kind of tweeting about it and getting people aware of what we were doing, the opportunity to roar engine kill when a Titan gets killed, because it's a big deal when a Titan gets laid low or, you know, taken out of the game. So it was always a great opportunity to be roaring engine kill. And Rue would have great fun shouting it because he didn't have any engines that could be killed in return. So it was a complete...
Yeah, and he did it a lot as well. I was actually at an event the start of the year before lockdown took place. I think it was February. There was an Adeptus Titanicus event. I was taking place in the Aeronautica event that was happening at the same time. Saturday morning, Wade, when the first person in the hall full of like 60 people playing Adeptus Titanicus, the first person got on his stool and shouted, "Engine kill!" after about 10 minutes of the event being on. And the whole hall disrupted in applause. It was great. Really, really cool. It's such a moment for everybody.
I wanted to talk a little bit about the rules, but I think both of us were probably of a mind that we put the Titans that we wanted to together and decided what colours and stories we wanted. And then comparatively late in the process, we found out what that would actually do in the game. And then we get tactical advice from the great Rob Crouchley and others to help us get to the best results out of the things that we decided to take. And that's another virtue, I think, of the Titanicus game, that they're Titans. They're all really good at something. Blowing buildings up or other Titans. Some of them might be long range, some might be medium range, some of them might have a variety of different things that they can do. You should feel compelled or encouraged to build the Titans that you like the look of, and you'll certainly find a role for it, or magnetize them as you've done, and then make sure they've got the weapon fit for all seasons. I would rather like to think that if I needed a particular loadout for a Titan, just make another Titan. It's the days of the Age of Darkness. The Titan Legions have got the numbers. If they need a dedicated Titan to do a dedicated thing, just get another one.
You're right, but it's a lot of work for you, the human hobbyist, isn't it? Do that. So I'm like you, Wade. I sort of like built my first Titans because what looked cool, that gun looks cool. And then I don't know about you, man, but like playing some games through and finding out what was good against certain things and how my Titans would work together as a maniple meant I sort of started thinking, okay, I need to lose this weapon here or add this weapon in. in a game of Titanicus, there's two main sorts of weapons, right? You've got the high number of shots but low strength weapons, like a Vulcan Mega Bolter, for example, that strip the enemy shields down, because enemy shields need to be brought down first before you can get to the juicy meat behind the shields. And then once those shields have come down, the big weapons in the force, like the volcano cannons, the thermal cannons, come into play and deal massive damage to the exposed Titan. So it's important to have both types of weapons in your force. And so as my games went on, I sort of realized I've not got enough weapons stripping Titans. So maybe I'll take a couple of Warhounds with the Vulcan Mega Bolters, because they're great at doing it. They are so good. But the problem is, of course, if you lose those Warhounds, then the massive Titans at the back, the Warlords and the Reavers with the big, sort of massive cannons, might not be able to get the shields down in time. If you've lost the Warhound. So it's they all fight together, which I really like the idea of. Is that how you came to think of your Titans as well?
Yeah, I think so. And I think because I've got that kind of Chaos Warband mentality about them still, yeah. And I knew that the Warlord was going to be the biggest and spikiest and angriest, that there'd be a kind of gathering around the strongest vibe to it. But unfortunately, shot myself in the foot a little bit, because as part of this kind of Tale of Four Princeps, it was a 5-month, I think, collecting journey. And we all started with nothing, an ambition and some Titan miniatures, and then we finished with a big group. But I say that, but I had tried to get a Tale of Four Princeps off the ground earlier in the year, and because you're great, you jumped straight in with both feet, painted a Legio Griffonicus battle group, and then I said, actually, sorry, we're not doing it, and you had a Legio Griffonicus battle group, and then 6 months later I said, we're doing it again, Tale of Four Princeps, and you did another Legio Griffonicus battle group. So you had quite a few Titans to play with, and I had planned that I would paint a Warlord Titan for the fifth and final game of the Tale of Four Princeps series.
Yep.
So I spent 4 months trying to keep Warlord Titans off me, being helped by knights.
Of course.
Looking to my left, does my colleague in arms rue? He's not got a single Titan. He's not even got a Warhound Titan, let alone a Warlord Titan. And there was one game where we faced off against you and Laura, and each of you had a Warlord Titan.
Yeah, we did that. It's not very honourable, but you know, victory is its own honour in a way, right?
Yeah.
Did we even win that game? I'm not sure we did.
It doesn't matter, does it? I don't even recall. I feel like, because there was 5 games, and I think the traitors did win, but that's just me telling history as I choose.
I think the 5th game decided it, Wade. But either way, I think it's worth going back and watching it on Warhammer Live if you've not already.
But yeah, on twitch.tv/Warhammer, which is where Warhammer Live live streams and then banks everything that we put out there in the videos on demand archive. If you go to twitch.tv/Warhammer, and if you find the videos link, click videos and then find collections, and then we have dedicated collections for each of the game systems that we've supported on Warhammer Live. So since Adeptus Titanicus came out in this incarnation, we've had all of our interviews with the design staff about the game, about the expansions, loads of battle reports featuring a whole cast of people with different Titan legions, different proclivities and all sorts of different rules being used. And then the crowning glory in many ways was our Tale of Four Princeps series at the end of last year. So if you like Titanicus and you haven't had a chance to watch that, then you should definitely go and check it out. And if you've had your interest piqued and you'd like to go and see what Titanicus looks like in action, we've got quite a lot of videos showing lots of different armies, including relative newcomers to it, kind of learning their way through the Four Princeps series.
Crucially, by Wade, Rob Crouchley in the background explaining everything. Which is great.
Rob Crouchley has recently been instated as a games developer in the Special Design Studio, so he has been invaluable to our coverage of Adeptus Titanicus and other games, helping to explain the rules and the intent, and commentating when the presenters were at the table shouting engine kill at one another, and helping the people, the viewers, understand how the game works. So yeah, we're delighted to see Rob is going to be able to carry on that great work in the studio right into us in the future. We had a great cast of characters altogether. There's some special guests featured, yeah, James from the 40K studio, also a fine upstanding collector of the Legio Vulpa, to bring in a different traitor complexion. He's also got a beautiful looking traitor force. I borrowed some of his tips, I think, for painting his Legio Vulpa Titans. But yeah, it was all about the just get up there and punch them. I was just reminding myself of the rules that I went for. Legio Vulpa, honor or death, you get more weapon skill, but lower ballistic skill when you're close to the enemy, because they just can't really be relied on to do things at range. They just want to do things up close, which still just means point blank firing of weapons, necessarily kicking them, but there is a bit of kicking.
It's the Wade maniple. That's the one that you go for, isn't it?
So the Ferox-like maniple. This is one that's just got Reavers and Warlord, or Warhounds, beg your pardon. So I couldn't make use of anything with a Warlord in it until the fifth and final game because I've not painted them. But I was looking at what could be done with combinations of Reaver Titans and Warhound Titans. And the Ferox-like maniple was right up my street because it encourages you to get up close and personal. There is an ability called Knife Fighters. Titans bringing knives to a gunfight where when you're within 2 inches of the enemy, you get to choose either your weapon skill or ballistic skill. So even though I'm maybe a little hot-headed for being Legio Volpa, by putting in that Ferox Light Maniple, still got the option to pick what would be the best set of dice to roll. And there was one game in particular, I think the penultimate game, before I'd painted up all three of the Bloodthirsters that I'd made, I used this first lad, Big Exalted Bloodthirster, to represent the Bloodthirst Stratagem, which is from the Doom of Moloch expansion, which is +2 to all hit rolls made against enemies within 2 inches this round. So I just got to stack a load of your Titan that's near my Titan. I'm going to hit you really hard, really effectively, really violently. And it was a bit of a one-trick pony, but it's a trick that I really like.
It worked well.
It's all right. I think in the very final game, I managed to get off because I think I was using the Venator Light Maniple, which is the one where if the the Warhound Titans of the Maniple manage to strip the shields of an enemy Titan, the Reaver Titan immediately gets to fire at that shieldless Titan. Which I didn't. I don't think I managed to get a kill shot off, but it was still very satisfying to see. That's the ambition. That's what you want to do if you've got this maniple. You want to drop the shields of the Titan, and then instantly, out of sequence, your Reaver with his volcano cannon gets to
place it. I use the but for me, way I use the Axiom Battle Maniple because crucially, when I bought the Titan Battle Group box when it first dropped, and that's the maniple that came in that box. Great. I had a maniple in the box. Don't want to think about it anymore. For me, like you, Wade. For me, the rules came second. I sort of like basically looked at the rules almost for the first time before I was about to play my first game. I painted everything up, then looked at the rules. I was like, oh, cool. There's maniple rules and Legio rules. Excellent. This is the kind of gamer I am, unfortunately. So I use the Axiom Battle Maniple, which allows you to every turn re-roll a failed command check, which is super important when you're unlucky on the dice like I am, and also important when you need that thing to happen. Not reroll command check. It allows you to carry on making commands to other Titans after you fail the first one. So I might sort of go full strong on that Reaver. I failed. Rats. Well, normally that means I can't make any more orders, but with an Axiom Battle Maniple, that means I can still carry on making orders to other Titans, which is crucial because sometimes I just need the things to happen. So that's what I went for. And sure enough, in many of the games we played, it was crucial that I had to get orders through. It meant my Titans were always mobile. And I could rely on them a bit more than I normally would be able to. But I tell you what, Wade, there's been a number of other maniples that have been released as special rules throughout all the books. And they all look great, man.
Because when we finished the Tale of War Princeps series, there was only the Adeptus Titanicus rulebook and the Titan Death and Doom of Moloch expansions. And then since then, we're just checking over. We had Shadow and Iron in February, Defensive Razor in August, and the most recent release was Crucible of Retribution. And they've all added more rules for legions, more rules for maniples, more stratagems, and loads of additional campaign stuff and world-building stuff, which is an absolute delight for me, but isn't really necessarily that specifically related to the Titans or the Titan fighting. Were there anything that caught your eye in any of those newer expansions that you would have?
Loads, both the Legios and the Maniples in particular. So the first thing, I always look at the new Maniples when they arrive in books like this, because it's like, how can I use the collection I've already got in a new way? And there's a couple that have really excited me. One was the Firmus Light Maniple, which came in Defensive Riser. That is a Reaver, 4 Warhounds, and the option of having 2 extra Reavers. Rules allow you to pick a new Titan nearest the... So if you shoot me, you shoot at one of my Reavers, I can pick a new target for your shot. Basically, right, the Warhounds jump in the way, which is pretty cool. So the Warhounds in that pretty much disposable, which is fine. You give them the light armaments, let them run forwards, that's great. They had to be nearest the enemy, so as long as you've got a screen of Warhound Titans, your Reavers are fine. And of course, in Legio Griffonicus, we're all about those Reavers. So that's perfect for me. The other one I quite liked is the Fortis Battle Maniple is in Doom of Moloch. That's 2 Warlords and 3 Reaver Titans with the option of having another Warlord and a Reaver. I've got that painted. And in this particular one, the Titans stand base to base and form a shield line, right? And so long as they haven't moved that turn, they ignore all modifiers coming in from structure damage and being hit in the flank, and they can merge their shields together. So they form one massive shield line of Titans, I was like, oh, I'm so about this. So that might just be the one I start using, because if I'm going to stand at the back and shoot people to death, well, if I do it, brilliant. Of course, and there are some scenarios where I have to move, and of course that means that scenery would be a problem, because I have, it'd be easy, because the enemy's going to know where I'm going to be at all times, because I can't move to get take part of this, take these rules on. So it's got its pros and cons there, I reckon. What about you, man? Any maniples take your fancy?
Yeah, similarly, I was looking to see what could I fit my existing collection in. So at the moment, I've got the Warlord Titan, 3 Reavers, 4 Warhands, and 3 counts as Questorus Knights. And there is a another Battle Force Maniple, the Dominus Battle Force Maniple, that comes in the Defensive Riser book, which is 1 Warlord, 2 Reavers, and 1 Knight Banner, either Questorus or Carastus, I think. And then up to 2 Warhounds, and up to 1 more Knight Banner. So I could fit the models that I have. I could fit the 3 Bloodthirsters that I'd made as Questorus class knights into that, and that has a similar sort of in the way you can assign hits to the knights that would have otherwise hit the titans, because they all form together in one big maniple. So I looked at that as a way of getting some of those models into a maniple if I did want to change up the way I was building my army, and if I add more miniatures in the future and I want to find a different way of putting them all together, I might make use of that. But it is really hard for me to look beyond the Ferox like maniple, and I've committed to just hitting things for the glory of the Warmaster Khorne. I should just lean into that. So I think, yeah, it would be interesting to try it out with the different. I haven't got quite as many different models as yourself to try out the different permutations and combinations, but I might give it a go at some point in the future. You also added a Warbringer Titan to your force.
Yeah, man, here he is. He's not got a name yet, so I should give him a name at some point soon. No, he's not, but I just painted him during the lockdown because I had him on hand. So yeah, there he's done, ready to fight. And I was looking at some of the maniples I would use him in as well. And there's a couple that have come recently. So first of all, in Shadow and Iron, we've got the Arcus Battleline Maniple, 1 Nemesis and 4 Warhounds. Again, I've got that done. Allows you to fire with a Nemesis indirectly. The Warbringer can fire indirectly with this massive cannon. Great. If I paint another one, which I plan on doing, I could use the Ruptura Battleline as well, which is Reavers can push to locomotion. So basically, it's two Nemesis sit at the back with their big guns, 2 Warbringers, and then 3 Reavers, right? The Reavers can push to locomotion without a reactor roll. That's massive. All of a sudden, you can automatically move the addition. I think it's up to 8 inches for a Reaver if they push to locomotion automatically. And whenever a Nemesis Warbringer destroys a Titan, all Reavers make a free move. What? Oh, wow. Yeah, right? Isn't that great? And the chances are that's going to happen. So blow that Warhand away and all the Reavers move. That's amazing. And there's another one as well, the Crucible of Retribution, that just arrived for 1 Warlord, 1 Warbringer, 1 Warhound, and with the option of taking another Reaver and another Warhound. And every strategy phase, you pick an order. For the rest of that round, the order is passed on a 2+. So basically, when you really, really want your army to be first firing, right? Yeah. You go, I'm going to pick the first fire order to be on 2+ this round, and everyone passes it on a 2+, on a D10, no doubt. That's so good. It makes your force really reliable. Or if you want to make sure everyone's moving fast, you've got that as well. So I love that one.
It's great when you can identify there's going to be a particular turn. There's going to be a turn where everything's going to turn on this turn, and we just get to either stack all the stratagems or all of the maniple abilities at once to make sure you get that decisive death blow.
Absolutely.
I love the stratagems, the Bloodthirst stratagem that I got to drop into the close combats earlier on in our series. But also, every one of those expansions has come with a few new ones. And I was looking at the experimental locomotors in the Defensive Riser, where you get to pick a Titan that always moves at its boosted speed. But on the D10 roll of 1 in the end phase, you lose the stratagem and it takes a devastating hit to its legs, reminding me of Hot Dog and its entry into the game. Just to be able to have a speedy Titan. And, you know, if you roll a 1, it's not great, is it? But you're not going to roll a 1, are you? It's not going to happen. Just speeding around with a combat Reaver Titan. Might be excited to try that. And there was I can't remember the name of it, I think it's a kind of a warp-tainted ground sort of stratagem that's only available to the traitors, because there's a number of traitor-only or loyalist-only stratagems where if your enemy's titans don't move, they take damage for just hanging around in the ground. So knowing that there might be, if there's anything in your battle plan that might compel you to try to stay still, I might be able to break out some of the dirty ground stratagems that could poison the ground under your feet even as you stand there. Good. So there's definitely loads of other rules. Like 3 expansions have been released since we last got to play Titanicus together as part of this group. So I'm sure when we do finally get a chance to reunite and play, we've got an awful lot of games we want to tick off. And I'm sure this conversation is going to be inspiring us. I know you've already been
so much.
What else could you add in? So we've definitely nailed our colours to the masts regarding the legions that we like. If you did have to pick another one, if you were forced to, you know, for fun, what other legions might attract your interest?
Well, so you've asked the question there. I mean, I'd probably say I've always wanted to do a Legio Solaria force since I saw them in some books before. They are the Imperial Hunters. And back in the day, do you remember in Epic there was the giant Imperator Titan that was painted green?
Yep.
That was Legio Solaria. And for me, that was like, I think it was on the front cover of the Epic 40,000 box set, front cover of the rulebook as well. I believe, if memory serves me right.
Yeah, Epic 40,000. That was a big, the metal Warlord Titan.
That's right. Yeah, it was massive. Yeah. Was it in Warlords? Okay, cool. Yeah. Basically, that in my mind was like, that's the first Titan image for me that really sort of struck. And I was like, I want to do these guys. Turns out that's Legio Solaria. Their color scheme slightly changed since to a sort of slightly lighter green metallic. But they are, they're sort of like the ultimate hunters. They're all female princeps as well. And they are basically, they are all about moving fast. The rules let them form bigger packs of Warhound Titans and even repair the legs on the Titans as well, so they can keep going. They repair their legs better.
And there's You're a scarred by hot dog, aren't you? You really
need to fix your legs. There's a piece of war gear called the Cameline Shrouding, which means they get to hide at longer range. So literally hiding in the shadows in their Warhound Titans and then all burst out and hunt. That sounds so cool and a very different way of playing to my Legio Graphonicus. If I had to go traitor wave, and I can't believe I'm even thinking about it, I'd probably go for Legio Mortis, the Death's Heads. They're from both Titan Death and Defensive Rise. They've got their rules in there. But basically, they're the archetypal bad guys. I've got the archetypal good guys, so I might as well go for the archetypal bad guys. It means I'd have enough models painted. I want to be able to play introductory games with people as well, so if someone goes, what's this all about? I'd love to be able to pull out two sides and go, right, let's have a game. And they're obviously the ones from the most famous ones from the rulebook, basically. And they've got transfers, which really helps. And they've got pretty cool rules as well. So that's pretty much where I'd go. How about you, Wade? If you ever turned loyalist, where would you go with this, man?
Well, I've considered, I think it's a bit of a theme amongst Titanicus collectors, the idea of having some loyalist and traitor forces, because you only need a couple of Titans of each to be able to introduce new people to the game if you've got those models available. And going back to that bit of background from the Mechanicum novel, there's a bit of me that would like to do the Legio Honorum, the Death Bolts, just to do that. Let's play that intro game where I get to wipe out 19 of your Titans in the first hour of the battle on Mars. But it might genuinely be a little self-contained thing, because my Legio Volpa force, the battle group and the maniples I'm collecting, are out in the wider Imperium. They're not taking part in the Schism of Mars, because when you're on Mars, you're going to get blockaded in there for a long time. So for my forces to be crusading around the galaxy and taking part in the Titan Death, I'm not collecting the Legio Volpa Titans that are on Mars. But maybe I will. Maybe I'll do like a little splinter project of the ones that can't leave home. It's got the home Legio Volpa force and the away Legio Volpa force. But as a consequence of writing some thoughts up for this podcast, I was having a check to see how many different Titan legions have their own rules at the moment. And I'd just like to list them because they sound great. The names are brilliant. And it's worth observing that there are no loyalist or traitor legions. History does not really record that necessarily. And when you play Titanicus, you play as a loyalist or a traitor player. You can choose to collect a notionally well-regarded loyalist legion. I could collect a force of Legio Graphonicus Titans who'd turned traitor, who'd turned their cloaks and blackened their shields and joined the Warmaster. Not recorded by history, Nick wouldn't even have it countenanced, but it could happen. So none of these legions are all loyalist or traitor, but some of them have some strong associations. And I'll just run through the names because they sound great. And you can decide for yourself, do you think these sound like good guys or bad guys? The answer might surprise you. At the top, the Legio Astorum, the Warp Runners, Legio Astroman, Morning Stars, Legio Ataris, Firebrands, Legio Audax, the Ember Wolves. That's the one that I do. Warhound only, armed with Ursus Claws, pick and fight with bigger, angrier things. That's the one that I had. Another ostensibly traitor legion. The Legio Crucius, the Warmongers, the Legio Domitium, the Unbroken Lords, the Legio Defensor, the Nova Guard, Legio Fortitus, Dauntless, Legio Furians, Tiger Eyes, Legio Graphonicus, the War Griffins, Legio Honorum, the Death Bolts, Legio Ignatum, the Fire Wasps, Legio Infernus, the Fire Masters, Legio Interfector, the Murder Lords, formerly the Lords of Valor. That is my favorite altogether. They're like, no, we've got rebrand. What did it used to be? The Lords of Valor. What do you now? Murder Lords.
It's fine.
Hurt you? What did you do? The Legio Kratos, the God Breakers, who are ace. Yeah. Legio Kulisaitai, the Gatekeepers. Legio Laniascara, Legio, the Impalers. Legio Lysander, the Sentinels of the Edge. Legio Magna, the Flaming Skulls. Legio Mordaxis, the Death Dealers. Legio Mortis, the Death Heads. Legio Oberon, Death Bolts 2. They need some more. Legio Osidax, the Cockatrices. Legio Prisagius, the True Messengers. Legio Solaria, Imperial Hunters. Legio Tempestus, Stormlords. Legio Tritonus, Dark Tide. Legio Venator, Iron Spiders. Legio Volcanum, Dark Fire. And the other Legio Volcanum, Lords of Ruin, Legio Vulpa, Deathstalkers, and Legio Volturum, Gorecrows.
Gorecrows, that's a wicked name.
Yeah, none of these are fully traitor or loyalist. There's room for a little bit of freedom for anyone's collection journey, but you can definitely get the sense of some of the, again, like, we were the Lords of Valor, now we're the Murder Lords. We used to prize valor above all, now we think murder is the most important thing. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. I wonder where they've got. Of course, if you do want to declare traitor or loyalist, there are rules in the Defense of Riser book for actually declaring yourself an allegiance to that side, which is pretty cool. And also, wait, there's rules for if you're not quite sure, if you're kind of in the middle, you can declare yourself as a Black Shield as well, which is pretty cool.
Yes.
Rules for that in Defense of Riser, pretty cool. Don't sit on the fence, though. Come on, declare. Come on.
Pick a side. History will remember. And there were originally rules in White Dwarf, I think, for creating your own Crusade type legion that might have slight variation. You might love the colours and the history of a particular legion, but want them to fight in a slightly different way. You get the scope to do that, or to create your own legion. And they've been reprinted now in Defensive Razor as well. So there's loads of great stuff. 32 and counting. There are plenty more legions out there, I'm sure. And that's not even to consider the Night Houses, of which there are many as well.
There are hundreds, yeah.
So, yeah, maybe a little bit of me wants to do a Legio Honorum Force just to get killed, but I think I'm more likely to just add in some Legio Ordax Ember Wolves with those Warhound Titans with the Ursus.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
A nice kind of mottled dark red scheme that I think would not look out of place alongside my Legio Volpa lads.
The Legio Kulisaitai, or Kulisaitai, the Gatekeepers, really struck me as something I wanted. Their colour scheme is sort of like, they're loyalist, naturally. They're red, white, and gold. It's like, that's a beautiful colour scheme. And really, really, if I was going to do another loyalist, maybe it might be them as well. I don't know. I don't know the rules, though. I hadn't looked at those. I'll look at the colour schemes first.
As we've learned, you don't need to worry that much about the rules. We'll find rules and find ways of making them effective once you've put together the things that you want to put together. I'm sure the Emperor, the Omnissiah, will find use for them on the battlefields of the Age of Darkness altogether. We were going to be doing a campaign, and just before the lockdown kicked in, we were making plans for doing a map-based Adeptus Titanicus campaign on Warhammer Live, which obviously the lockdowns interfered with, but we would definitely love to be able to do that in the future, because there's so many campaign resources out now in each of these expansions that are coming out. There's more and more information for people to create their own star systems and then blow them up so that history never gets to record them into the 41st millennium. I think it's one of the things I love the most about the setting, the Age of Darkness, not only the scale and the scope of the miniatures and the battles that we see with Titans, but just knowing that entire star systems will be getting obliterated and wiped out and lost to human history. And collectors and players, we get to tell those stories. We get to set fire to entire regions of space. And even though, having gone back to the beginning of saying, I'm collecting the traitors, I know we lose, there's still huge scope to win in campaigns and take as many of the loyalists down with you as possible and achieve some measure of victory for the Warmaster in the greater scheme of things, and kind of not worry too much about how it all ends.
Never, dude. I can't wait. In fact, I really hope once this COVID is over that we're going to get that campaign back on again. I can't wait to do some fighting. Maybe it might even be a map. If there's a map,
What's the plan? Yeah, we're going to be using the invasion style. I think Tom Clark, games developer from the studio who's been writing these campaign rules, was going to be offering his services as a campaign organizer. And he is a noted traitor sympathizer. So I think that was going to go very well indeed. So look forward to get that up and running. And then I guess Titanicus and Armies on Parade. We've seen a few cool Armies on Parade entries previously. Like last year, there was a stunning entry. I think it's one of my all-time favorite Armies on Parade entries, with planes swooping out of a firestorm and Imperator Titan converted from maybe an Imperial Knight or some such. Getting a sense of that scale as people start to engage with Armies on Parade this time around. Now there's a huge amount of Titans and Knights miniatures at that scale, and Aeronautica miniatures at the same scale. I'm sure we'll be seeing all sorts of cool things.
That's it, isn't it? Like, for Armies on Parade, something it's a smaller scale, whereas you might be able to sort of show a small Rohan village in Middle Earth, or maybe like a small sort of courtyard in 40k. And that's Titanicus. You can show a city, pretty much most of it, because it's so small. There's one I've seen recently. I just saw it on Twitter today, actually. Someone called Amoeba Bait on Twitter has made a really cool Aeronautica and that's a Titanicus board. But they've used like an Imperial Bastion, but from 40k, and merged two of them together and put little small bits from the Adeptus Titanicus scenery kits all over to scale it. So you've got this massive Bastion from 40k size building as a background to an Adeptus Titanicus board with sort of knights and some planes and stuff. And it's so cool. A great use of the scenery. I can't wait to see what people's imagination brings them to do for Armies on Parade. Wade, it's not far away, is it?
Really not. Nope. Not at all. So yeah, we'll be looking out for that and seeing what other exciting, inspiring hobby stuff there is to be taken away from that and inform what we do in the future. Right, we are pretty much out of time, I reckon. So we need to get on with the rest of our day. But it has been a delight to catch up and think about the Tale of Four Princeps and Adeptus Titanicus and what we might do in the future with you again, Mr. Baton.
Always a pleasure. Thanks for having me, Wade. Thank you.
Not at all. Yeah, I think be inspired to go and do a bit more Titanicus hobby. I'm sure you might see a bit of Titanicus from us before too long.
Absolutely.
And if are a big fan of Adeptus Titanicus, I hope you've had an enjoyable time listening to us reminisce about our most recent hobby engagement with the Adeptus Titanicus hobby. If you're new to Titanicus, or if you've not committed to it yet, or if you've not seen it played, do check out twitch.tv/Warhammer and find the Adeptus Titanicus collections and see what you think of it. Thanks very much for joining us, everyone. We'll be back next week for another episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. We'll see you very soon.
Bye.